opportunity to be a blessing to the people of God. May this word go forth with all simplicity and clarity in power in the name of Jesus. May this land be blessed by the reason of the word of God that we go forth today. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen. This is Bible Concepts with the Darling Pastor. And I am the Darling Pastor, Reverend Gbade Ogunlana. We have been looking at the responsibilities of the Christians, believers, to our community, to our nation, to the world in general. We have considered the fact that we are to pray for the people that are in authority. The Bible says that pray for those that are in authority. That is one of our duties. We are looking at something else again today. There are so many believers that, yes, we are going to heaven, but they neglect to fulfill their own duties here on the earth. No, we are not here by accident. We are here for a purpose, and we ought to be of a blessing. What are the responsibilities of believers in this nation that we belong to? Apart from praying for the people that are in authority, which we find out that it is for our sake. We realize that the more we pray for the people that are in authority, the better we will be able to live in peace, as well as living in all honesty. The Bible says that we should pray for the people that are in authority, that we may live in all honesty and godliness. Romans chapter 13 from verse 1 is our text today. The Bible says in Romans chapter 13, verse 1, let also be subject unto the higher powers. For there is no power that but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. I want us to look at something in this particular teaching. The fact that as a citizen, we are expected of God. We are demanded by God to respect or obey the authority of the land. As Christians, we are expected to obey the authority that is set in the land. That is our subject today. In Romans chapter 13, verse 1, the Bible says that let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. What that simply means is this. It's saying that let every citizen be subject or obey. The higher powers here is talking about the authority of the land. For there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. I've seen a whole lot of politicians, when they get to power, they say something like, well, if God doesn't want me to be here, I cannot be here, because the power that be are ordained of God. I am ordained to be here. You know, interestingly, this passage is not talking about you or the person that is fulfilling or sitting in the position. What is this scripture talking about? This scripture actually is talking about that God is the one that sets hierarchies of authority. That is, God is the one that looks at the community of men, and in his infinite wisdom, he knew that men ought to have hierarchies of authority. They ought to have leaders over them for things to work out well. So what this scripture is saying is that God is the one that ordains that there be hierarchies of authority. Any system that will last and operate effectively must have hierarchies of authority. There is the hierarchies of authority in heaven. Even there is the hierarchies of authority in hell. Remember those demons that came to Jesus? Well, the Pharisees came to Jesus. They couldn't explain the reason or the secret of the power of the Lord Jesus, how he was casting out the devil. So they came up and said, He must be casting out the devil using the power of the devil. Why? Because they knew that even in the kingdom of darkness, there is the hierarchies of authority. And Beelzebub is expected to be of a higher power. So they now said, he's using Beelzebub to cast out the devils. Why? Because they know that in the kingdom of darkness, there is also the hierarchies of authority. In the kingdom of God, there is also the hierarchies of authority. Among the angels, the Bible talks about the archangels. Archangels means senior angels, leaders among the angels. We have the hierarchies of authority. The Bible is now saying that even among men, God established that there will be hierarchies of authority. That is what this Romans chapter 13 is saying. No, it's not saying that everyone that is imposed is put there by God. Why? You and me know that a whole lot of people can cheat, they can rig, they can do sort, and they be in position of authority. Are they all the ones put there by God? No, no, no. God didn't want Israel to have a king. The people pushed Saul there. God was forced to establish or create a room of a particular lineage or pattern of leadership whereby kings are enthroned who twisted the hands of God. The children of Israel, God didn't have a choice than to establish that for them. But you could see that he was not interested in Saul being the king. We can all see the outcome of the people forcing the hand of God to give them a king by force. So God was the one that established the hierarchies of kingship for them when they forced his hand. But he wasn't the one that wanted Saul to be there. So you could see that when people say, well, if God doesn't want me here, I can't be here. No, you can be there even if God doesn't want you there. If you know your way. So we see here that there is something about God establishing hierarchies of authority for the community of men, for us to enjoy, for the system to work well. God ordains and establishes hierarchies of authorities also. In other words, God is the one that says there must be leaders among men for the system to work well. There must be leaders among men for the system to work well. So it says in Romans chapter 13, verse 1, let every soul be subject unto higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. We can say the hierarchies of powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever resisted the power resisted the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. Here we are looking at one of the functions or the responsibilities of every citizen, including believers. We are to recognize, respect, and obey the authority of government that is set in our country. No matter which nations you belong to or you live in the whole world, there is the hierarchies of authority that is established. And your job and my job as a citizen is for us to obey the rulers. Is for us to obey the hierarchies of authority that is set over us. You see, in the world today, we can divide things into about two or three. You have the military government, you have the civilian government. Among the civilian, you can have the democracy, you can have the communism, you can have socialism, all sorts are there. But once there is an hierarchy of authority in any nation, if you are to live in that nation, you are expected to obey the authority that is established in that nation. That is a God-given commandment. It says, whosoever therefore resisted the power or resisted the hierarchy of authority that is established, you are resisting the ordinance of God. And they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. For rulers are not a terror to good works. Here he is explaining something about rulership. The intent of God. Why did God establish hierarchies of authority in the body or in the world? When it comes to governmental system of the world, why did God establish the hierarchy of authority? He says that in verse 3, Rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. So the essence of having rulers is for the rulers to face or to challenge or to stop or to hinder the perpetration of evil. That is the primary purpose. So we have leaders to make sure that goods happen in the country or in the nation. They should stop the operation or the spreading of evils by making sure that they withstand evils. The Bible says in that verse 3, for rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Without them, not be afraid of that of the power. Do that which is good, and thou shalt have the praise of the same. Very interesting. Here, the Bible is splitting the operation or the functions, what is expected of the government, into two here. Number one, it says resist the evil. Number two, praise the good. There should be a system of rewarding good. Then there should be a system of punishing evil. Those are some of the things that are expected of the leadership. They are to resist the evil and praise the good. God will help us in Africa and give our leaderships wisdom. It's one of our duties as a citizen to pray for them so that they will be wise and they will know how to rule us aright. I established something last week in the last teaching that you hardly can live holier than the system will permit you to live. But for the system to be working on effectively, we've got to pray. And our prayer should center on praying for the leaders so that the leaders will have understanding, so that the leaders will be able to leave us and control the system and make sure that peace reign in the land. So the Bible says in verse 3, for the rulers are not a terror to good work, but to the evil. Without not be afraid of the power, do that which is good, and thou shalt have the praise of the same. Verse 4 now says, for he is the minister of God to thee for good. Now the Bible calls him minister of God to thee. You know what he's talking about here? He's talking about people that are leading naturally. He's talking about the governor of a state. He's talking about the governor of a state. Talking about the local government chairman, talking about the mayor, talking about, you know, he's talking about leadership here. He said, actually, these leaders are ministers of God. This is one of the things that we leaders ought to know, that no matter how they find themselves there, once you are there, you are there. And you will give account to God. Whether by hook or crooks, you will still give account to God. Why? Because he says here, for they are ministers of God. What it means to be ministers of God is that they also have responsibilities towards God. They've got to give God an account of how they have led. Very interestingly, no matter which political party brought them there, no matter the system of rulership of that nation, once you are there, remember that you are a minister of God for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid. For he beareth not the sword in vain. For he is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. Very interestingly, the Bible says that the leaders are put there to make sure they punish evil. No, the leaders are not there to pat the back of everybody. He says that they are there to punish evil. So if you are doing evil, he's saying be afraid, because they are bearing the sword, not for fun, but to make sure that they discipline the evil. Oh, if you can study the Bible, you see that the Bible is complete. He is giving us the duties of the leaders here. If you are a leader and you are not punishing evil, you are permitting evil, or you are supporting evil, you are also not fulfilling your God-given assignment. You are not there by chance. God is the one that establishes the hierarchies of authority. And once you have found yourself there, you are expected in the sight of God to make sure that you support the good and you punish the evil. And as a citizen, as Christians now, we are to obey. In verse 5, that's why it says, wherefore, you must needs be subject, not only for wrath, but also for conscience sake. So as a member, as a citizen in the land, in the nation, It's your job and my job as believers to make sure that we obey the people that are in authority. And that simple statement sometimes can be very tough, depending on the situation on ground, depending on the type of leadership that is around, depending on the system that is being run. You know, there are some certain things we have control over. There are things we don't have control over. For example, many times in several nations of the world, it's only very few percentage of the people that determines who their leaders will be. Well, in democratic system, they will say everybody vote. But the question is this, who do you vote for? Well, we are voting for Mr. Hay. Who chose Mr. Hay to be the one to be voted for? They are usually about among 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 people that chose that is Mr. Hay. So invariably, it's those people actually that determines who rules us. So sometimes you may not necessarily be in total, complete agreement with your leader, but you have a duty towards God. You are to obey the leaders. You are to obey the leaders. The leaders are expected to be one that ministers punishment to the evildoers, minister reward to the good doers. Your job and my job is to obey them. It is a duty under God. Why is it under God? Because we read here that God is the one that establishes that there will be authority, hierarchies of authority. It may not necessarily be God that put this particular person there, but God is the one that says there must be leaders, and leaders should know what they are expected to do. So it's your job and my job to obey them. Sometimes the system, they might put in some certain things, that policies that you may not necessarily agree with. Let me give you an example. Take, for example, if you're a rice farmer, and that is where you support your family. It is from rice farming that you get money to send your children to school. So you live on rice. And the more they buy it, the better. Your rice farm has become so big that you can't even finish all that you're harvesting from the farm. So you are forced to sell. It's getting bigger than that. You are forced to export. Now, you have calculated that if I export my rice, whatever, to some developed countries, to China, to US, to England, you'll be able to get some foreign currencies, which is a very good calculation, which makes some economic sense. Now, government comes up with a policy that there are some parts of the country where they are unable to grow rice, and government wants rice to spread land. So they lay embargo on exportation. Now, don't take that as a right to go against the government. Why? Because every authority or power that is established with God's approval. That's what he's saying here. That is, God is the one that says there must be leaders, there must be rulers. And they're not there for fun. Sometimes they may come up with policies that is against your own plans. It is not a right or a license for you to attack the government. We are to obey them. That is what this scripture is saying. We are to obey them, even as believers. Where you are living, there are sometimes as a person, you are living in a particular environment, and in the environment where you are living, you have to move to another country. Now, the laws that governs the operation in the country you move to might be different from the ones that governs the authority from where you are from. But as long as you are living in a particular country, you are expected to obey the law of that country. You don't come around and say, well, because I do not belong to this country, I am not going to obey the authority in this land. No. According to the law of God, when you see an established hierarchies of authority, when you see leadership set up, operating in a place, as long as you are there, you are to obey it. I was teaching in one church one time like that, and one woman asked a question and said, Pastor, my husband is at home. My husband loves me to wear trousers, even though I'm a lady. But the church that I attend, they insisted that I must dress in a particular way. They frown at a woman wearing trousers. What do I do? And I said, okay, this is what you do. Number one, as long as you are a member of that church, you have, in quote, sworn to obey the ordinance of that local assembly. Every local assembly has a right to have their ordinances, which you are compelled to follow or obey. So as per that church, they have a right to say what they are saying. It doesn't mean that what they are saying is right, but they have a right to say it. Did you get that? It doesn't mean that what they are saying is right, but they have a right to say it. So as far as that is concerned, that church has that right. And as far as you want to be a member of that church, you will have to obey their rules and regulations while you are in that church. Guess what? At home, your husband is your head, because the Bible says that the man is the head of the home. Oh, Pastor, I don't believe that. That is the genesis of problem for you. Because anything that doesn't have a head will not work. No, it will operate like an octopus, moving in every direction at the same time, looking confused. There must be a headship to any system that will work. And God established that man should be the head of the home. So man is the head of the home as established by God. Now, as though you are a woman in the home, but a member in that local assembly, if in that local assembly you are to obey the authority that is established in that local assembly, but you are not just a church member, you are also a wife. You have to obey the authority that is established by God concerning the home where your husband is your head. So how do we merge the two? When you go to church, you obey their commandments in church. When you get back home, you obey your husband back at home. I've seen many people challenge this answer. They say things like, Pastor, is that not hypocrisy? If you can't wear trousers in church, because the church says don't wear trousers, should you wear it at home because your husband says you should wear it? I tell you truly, wear it. Listen to this. There is a dressing in church which is different from home. Even the pastor himself dresses differently. Like I asked the other time, have you ever seen your pastor? Ask your pastor whether he wears collars at home. No, he also has house dressing. He dresses differently in church. So you also should do. But Pastor, my conscience is beating me. I'm not sure whether that is right or wrong. Let me give you a counsel. This is my advice to you. Change that church. Listen, if you are not going to be able to obey the authority that is established in any establishment or organization, change from that organization. Because when you walk against the established hierarchies of authority, you will be guilty. And there is the establishment of authority to punish such a thing. So if you are punished, don't blame anybody. That's what this Romans chapter 13 tells us, that the leaders are not bearing the sword in vain. He's saying that anytime you see a leader that is over you, let me read it again to you. In Romans chapter 13 from verse 1, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resisted the power, resisted the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. He says that when you resist, you will be punished. So instead of violating your conscience or coming against the authority, maybe you should just change church. I would rather advise you change church than you change husband. Well, don't you think so? Because when the commandments of the husband disagrees with that of the church, God is the one that sets up hierarchies of authority, and it is for smooth running of every system. So as a citizen in any nation of the world, are you a child of God? Are you a born-again Christian? One of your duties is to obey the rules and the regulation of the governmental system of that country. That is what the Bible established. I am the darling pastor. I'm Reverend Gbade Ogolana.